What's up, internet? I'm Daniel, the pitch professor, and this time I'm in for something slightly different. Now, I've had some issues with copyright with Shark's Tank and Dragon's Day, and I tried a little bit and... yeah. So I started looking around, and I found something that I've kind of grabbed my attention more or less instantly, and it's called Best Sales Pitch Ever, Don Draper sales pitch. Now, if you don't know who Don Draper is, you should. There's a show which is, I don't know, what, 10, 15 years old called Mad Men. So if you're a marketeer, you know it. If you're not a marketeer, you should probably take a look at it. It's very old school. It's very 1960s. And I didn't watch it that much back in the day because, well, I was founding my startup back then. Nevertheless, if someone calls something the best sales pitch ever, I need to take a look at it. Haven't seen it yet. Very much intrigued to see this. And without any further ado, let's go.
This is Joe Harriman and Lynn Taylor. No Eastmans today, unfortunately. They're all back in the lab.
It's a wonderful facility, but they don't take vacations.
What do they show? Slides of them working?
So have you figured out a way to work the wheel into it?
We know it's hard because wheels aren't really seen as exciting technology, even though they are the original.
I have to pause here. I don't know what they're talking about. I'm kind of missing the context. What kind of a wheel he or she may, he may have had to figure out. And that's something, however, I find interesting is as I'm missing the context, I don't know what they're on about. And this is something very often I have when I do pitch trainings with my clients. And again, I have not seen this in advance. Why? Because nor does your audience ever see what you do in advance. And when I do trainings with my clients, I always get the question, what do you want to know before? And I say, nothing. Because I want to have this pitch as pure and raw as it is on stage and then give feedback on it, then work on it, not know everything in advance. However, what I do find quite interesting is this scene here, just looking at, am I pointing the right way? Yes, I'm pointing the right way. This scene right here, because very often you'll have pitches in a small environment. I've had tons of them. And I find it so interesting is how a dynamic kind of evolves. And there, if you are the one who's visiting, very often as a team, it's interesting to observe, how do you handle this as a team? How do you get yourself set up? How do you introduce yourselves? And there's certain rules that reflect a lot about culture, manners, upbringing, anxiety, or whatever it is, and also team. So I find it quite interesting when people go into a room and greet, and I'm a big fan of the traditional ladies first. I fully believe in that, and then kind of working your way through the room and then trying to understand, how do you set up your device? Where's the cable? What do you do? And how can you already try and build some kind of an interaction with your audience? These could be just four people, five people in a room, while you are getting set up. And I've had this so often. And the funny thing is, on the inside, you're nervous. You want to get going. You're like a racehorse. But what I find so important is to get the setting right and to only start once everything is working. And it's something a lot of people tend to forget. They start rambling on. They're going at 100 miles an hour before. And that's something I say so often, slow down and only start once you are set up and happy. And what I was saying about teamwork, I find it so interesting. Sometimes in rare occasions, you'll have two people or more, and one person is going to be the outgoing character, already building a bit of a bond, doing a bit of a chit chat, while the second person is setting up the notebook and doing the more tech part in the background. And that's something, if you are trying to understand how a team works, that's kind of a positive thing. So there's no golden rule, but just something I think is interesting you might want to reflect about. Now, here it's quite clearly that Don Draper is actually not visiting anyone, but it's his office, so they are still there. Interesting that the other guys did not get up. Interesting from the body language as well. Don Draper is standing, kind of relaxed. The other guys are kind of more leaned back. I mean, it is in the 60s, so they're smoking, as you would. And yes, I know it's a show, but then again, it's a very well-done show. Body language is key. Let's go.
Well, technology is a glittering lure.
But there's the rare occasion when the public can be engaged on a level beyond Flash.
If they have- I got to stop here again. What I find also so fascinating here is he talks about technology as a glittering lure. But what I like is the way he starts to talk. He talks in a very slow, very, very clear manner. And this is something I see so often myself as a keynote speaker, but also as a trainer or host, is you want to go on stage and be really fast because you're full of energy. Yet, I find when you go on stage and you talk in a specific speed with clarity and decisiveness, that your audience enjoys and also listens to your words a lot clearer. Speed, pace, clarity is key. And look out, there's no ums and no uhs and no oohs. That's good. I don't think he's started the pitch yet, but still he's already starting and setting the scene by this.
I have a sentimental bond with the product. My first job, I was in-house at a fur company with this old pro copywriter, Greek, named Teddy. And Teddy told me the most important idea in advertising is new. It creates an itch. You simply put your product in there as a kind of calamine lotion. But he also talked about a deeper bond with the product. Nostalgia. It's delicate, but potent.
Don Draper. It's great the way he uses storytelling to build a bond with his audience. He has a story, he's delivering something in it, away from technology, so I'm assuming it's about some technology he's presenting, and over to a story. And he gives something small, and by this we can also see the way our audience, these two guys, just two guys, are actually switched on and are listening. And the calmness of his voice is directing their focus. And now he also, and that's something I enjoy so much, is being able to read your audience. We can see that they are switched on. Yes, they act us, but still one goes like, yeah, you're right. And I'm pretty sure now he has the maximum amount of attention to probably start his real pitch.
Sweetheart.
Yes, lights off. Really important one, I just noticed that this is hilarious. Two things. Number one is lighting, so the setting has changed. This is something you can use in a remote setting, the color of your slides. I used to do this a lot during COVID. I'd have white slides, knowing that people would probably be sitting at home in front of their screens, maybe in the evening. And if you suddenly change these slides to a black slide, by this, the lighting in the room changes. And also, in such a subtle way, the emotion. Now, something else why I had to cut in there, I just heard it. See, I've got these little in-ears, and for me, it's so important to hear the details. We've just had music set in. And this is something, this is Hollywood. I've seen thousands of pitches. Yet someone who actually uses music during their pitch to create an emotion, I think I've never seen it. I've seen keynote speakers do this, but on very rare occasions. It's very, very, very powerful. Yet I think it's something that's very hard to use from a timing wise. And I think personally it's overdoing it. So maybe you want to watch this scene and rewatch it and just look how not his speech, not the pictures, yet the music itself is creating the emotion. Try and divide this out. Try and dissect this out, but still watch it. So the pitch has started. Let me just go back a bit. Oh, but I just heard this music. Had to instantly comment on it. So emotion.
Teddy told me that in Greek, nostalgia literally means the pain from an old wound. It's a twinge in your heart, far more powerful than memory alone. This device isn't a spaceship. It's a time machine. It goes backwards and forwards. It takes us to a place where we ache to go again. It's not called the wheel. It's called the carousel. It lets us travel the way a child travels. Round and around, and back home again. To a place where we know we are loved.
Yes, this is how it's done. This is how it's done. This is great. So now I know the wheel. Now I understand that it's the carousel. He's selling this old device that would show pictures, dias, I think we used to call them. But the point being, look how he did it. He was not selling the device. He was selling what it does. And by that, he was selling the emotion it creates. People are not buying the technology. They are buying its, well, not even its function, its emotion. And I see it so often. So many people try so hard to pitch or sell a technology, but that's not what most people buy. Most people buy an emotion or a feeling or certain clarity. What do you buy? Let's say something boring. What do you buy when you buy an insurance? Do you buy the insurance? No. You buy the clarity of mind, or you buy the feeling of safety. What do you buy when you buy a car? You buy status, or the ability to go from A to B. Yet so often when I host pitching conferences or whatnot, most of probably you are trying to sell the technology and not the emotion behind. Imagine he would have said this. Now I know what they meant with the wheel. Would have said, this is the wheel. It's got, now I'm making this up. It's got 96 different slots. It's got 120 lumen, and it can show up to 60 pictures a second. It has blah, blah. And you go like, shoot me in the face. I have no idea what that means. Yet what he does, I was taking notes as I always do in my trainings. He said, what did he say? It goes back in time. Forwards and backwards. This device is a time machine. Oh, yes. Now, what I'd like you to do is think about your last pitches and think about what it is you were really selling. Is it a technology or is it an emotion? And an emotion can be much more. It can be in desire. It could be even as simple as saying, we don't do 17 teraflops of data per second, but we save you up to 80% of your time. This is powerful, 80% of your time. And the funny thing is, also the way he talked, most people go like, and it saves up to 80% of your time while doing 90% more efficiently. No, you got to say, and it saves 80% of your time. And what happens then is most people go like, really? Oh, really? I'm not sure. And while that happens, if you have connected with your audience, what happens is that these people start thinking. You want that. So their brain goes. And whatever you say in that time while their brain goes tick-tock is missed, no matter how brilliant it is. And this is something it took me, my goodness, it took me 10 years myself to be able to articulate this, to understand, to see this. But I think, compare this to comedians. as a comedian, what you want to do is you want to create the emotion that people laugh. So you tell a funny joke and people listen to your joke and are like, that was so funny. So what did they do? They laugh. What does the comedian do? He waits until the laughter's over and only then delivers his or her next line. What do we do when we pitch, when we sell? We deliver a thought. And we can't see or hear the thought that's created in people's heads. We have to anticipate it. We have to let our audience think and only then deliver our next line. I'd like you to reflect about that. And I'd be so curious to hear your viewpoints on this. I know it's a bit different than my other videos, but I love doing them so much. And I got a little, you know, unhappy about the fact that the last couple of videos got so heavily copyright infringed. So what you could do for me is, yeah, just drop me a line and say, hey, dude, yeah, that's right, that's good. Or maybe even say, look, take a look at this one, this video, that would be great. So think about it. Comedians make us laugh. People pitching make us think. I hope I made you think. If you like this, press the like button. If you really like this, subscribe. And if you want to make my day, just drop me a comment. By the way, it feels good to be back, kind of. In that sense, take care. Stay safe. Ooh. I'm missing 5 seconds of the video. I got so carried away. Let's listen into this.
Good luck at your next meeting.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Good luck at your next meeting. What does that mean? Probably they're going around watching different, listening to different pitches of different advertising companies and trying to pick the best. Yeah, that'll be hard. In that sense, good luck with your next pitch. Thank you very much. Take care, stay safe, and bye-bye.